Now it's 2:30, we can start. So I'm very happy to introduce today Steve Tono for this second keynote today. So Steve is a lecturer at University of Edinburgh in Scotland. And I would be very frank, he had his PhD here with advice together with Frank and I. He also turned to be a friend of mine, but this is not the reason I'm inviting him today. It's mainly because he's one of these few people that is closing a gap between robotics and computer graphics. And I think it's very interesting to do this. So there are a couple of people in the world that work on this. He knows the graphics community super well. He knows the robotics community super well. And I think it gives him a very special point of view on our topic. So. And I'm sure he won't work about what he did here, but what he did more recently. So I'm looking forward to see this, just like you. So please, Steve, the floor is yours. Thank you very much. Thank you.
So good afternoon, everyone. I believe that everybody can hear me okay. Thank you so much, Julien, for the introduction. It's a great pleasure for me to be back in Rennes after so many years. And today I'm going to talk about, indeed, robotics, but I'm going to talk about robotics from the point of view of someone who did a PhD in computer graphics, right? I was fighting a bit with the template for the MIG presentation. The title is so big I had to reduce it. To make it fit on the page. And so interestingly, I still wanted to put this picture of a robot. We'll see why in a minute. And I believe the size of that robot with respect to the title is actually saying something about my work. I'm not about my talk. I'm not going to talk too much about my work. I'm going to talk about how I see two fields that are usually separated. And even if there is a common consensus that there are many common grounds and many reasons to work together on this field, I still observe a lot that we tend to rediscover things from one hand to the other. And I believe that this is something that is disappearing now, and I would like to discuss why today. Okay. So my point of view when I graduated from my PhD, so this is back in 2015, was that indeed we were interested when it came to the animation of virtual characters or when it came to the animation of robots with legs, we were interested in the same problem, which is, you know, I'm a human, I want to go to the other side of the stage. I don't have a mic, so I won't do that. I'm interested in achieving this task. But the objectives, whether I'm trying to do this for a virtual character or for a robot, I used to think that they were quite different, right? The objective and the main constraint that we considered back then and that we still consider today are constraints on the visual quality, right? So I believe most of you will know this work from Daniel Holden in 2017. And what we are interested in this motion and why this work had a major impact is that the motion is plausible, it's natural, it's human-like, and somehow it is going beyond the motion capture database that was used to produce what we call a motion policy here. Okay, so for those of you who are not familiar with machine learning, a policy is just, we can say it's a black box function that given any state of the virtual character and an objective that it has to achieve, will give you instantaneously a command that must be executed for the robot to go somewhere. And so this is very impressive from a computer graphics point of view. And as a roboticist, however, the first thing that you will notice in this work is that you know there is no way this is going to run on your robot, right? And the reason why is that you can see you have a bit of foot skating, the feet are not correctly aligned on the stairs. And this is where the worlds used to differ. In the sense that we are saying, well, in robotics, we are not at all interested in visual quality, right? We're just interested in doing the things and doing it in such a way that we don't break anything. And by breaking anything, I mean the robot does not fall, it doesn't bring the environment, and it doesn't break the PhD student who's working close to it, right? And so if we have this, we are really happy. And this video, actually, I wanted to show it to you. This is the recent work of my PhD student, Thomas Corbert. And I believe, like, in terms of style, you won't find it super interesting. But in terms of what's happening here, I do believe it's the state of the art in robotics for many reasons. It's hard to see it, but the robot is constantly hitting the limit of what can be delivered. And when I say limit, it's like the amount of current that is necessary for it to generate torques to cross these big gaps is really, really important. So we're constantly dealing with the limits at max capability all the time. We don't have any sort of pre-computation. We don't know the environment before acting. We don't know anything. We plan everything in real time. Okay. So I'm very proud of this work. And yet the results are really different, right? And the priority obviously here are the constraints that we're going to put on whether the motion that you compute and that you want to, your robot to execute is achievable or not, right? And in the method that we've seen before, we were talking about learning an optimal policy that would guide you for any state of your system, you know, what action you should take to achieve your objective. And here, it's a different kind of approach that is used. It's at every time step, we solve what we call a trajectory optimization problem. So we just try to find one single trajectory given the current state that will tell us all of the actions that we need to do over a sequence of time to get to our objective. I'll come back to this a bit later. And nowadays, the frontier between these two kind of visions of what should be done when it comes to character animations are changing, right? And I think they are changing, for instance, with this video that I'm sure everybody has seen, but maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm very biased by the robotics field. So who knows Boston Dynamics? Who has seen the video that I'm going to play already? Okay, so still quite a few of you, right? And when you look at these motions, this is very impressive, okay? So you have the Atlas robot, he's carrying a box, he's doing some kind of parkour style locomotion, he's being very a show off, you know, like doing some completely unnecessary things, interacting with the environment, and then he's going to end up with a backflip, okay? And I want to be very clear, this is amazing. 5 years ago, no one had any idea that we could achieve this in robotics. This is crazy, okay? This is due to excellent hardware and a lot of work. And also, it's also thanks to a lot of contribution for the computer graphics, which I believe actually, I'm not sure people in Boston Dynamics are aware of. And we're going to talk about this in a minute. But we can see that regardless of all of this, the quality of this motion is very impressive, right? And it makes sense to say that if you're able to satisfy the constraints given by the physics of your problem, of the world, of course, you're going to obtain motions that are naturally looking good, that are plausible, that are natural, everything that we're looking in computer graphics, right? Because we follow, like we had a talk about, you know, energy minimization and those kind of principles of optimality, we are looking for them constantly in robotics and we're trying to address those. Then with respect to the other video that I show you, the robotics one, you can see that this is much more elegant, but the approach is completely different. I said that in this case, coming back to that previous video, nothing was pre-computed, right? We had online perception, online decision-making, all of that. And here, the approach is exactly the opposite. You can see a making of this video, which is quite nice. And you can see that hundreds and hundreds of hours were spent on that demo, repeating over and over the same task until this was achieved. Boston Dynamics is very honest about it. And still, that doesn't change at all the fact that it's amazing, okay? But this is just to say that those are very different approaches. And this is why I try to explain my friends, you know, when I show them a video, I say, look, it's awesome. And say, come on, you know, Boston Dynamics is doing that. Why do you? What are you trying to tell us here? And what is really interesting about this is that they're also very upfront about the kind of methods that they used to obtain this motion. So there is a talk, there used to be a talk from Scott Quindersma. There is one that is more up to date that was given by Robin Dates in France this summer. I hope that the slides maybe of the talk can be shared later on with the links. And he has an excellent talk where he explains all of that. And for those of you who were in the computer graphics community in the 90s, so before my own time, but you know, That's why bibliographies are for. You can see that what they use to achieve this is quite interesting. So on the right-hand side, they use something which is quite similar to what we've been using in that demo I showed you, which is like online trajectory optimization. We have a fancy word for that. We call it model predictive control. And basically, it just means that we just consider a sliding horizon, and we always plan a few seconds ahead what our robots need to do, and we just execute, you know, for instance, over this 5-second trajectory that we have planned, we execute the motion for 1 second, and then we start planning again. But on the left-hand side, what they did to kind of achieve this motion is they created a database of motions, right? And the database of motion is not achieved by motion capture. It's achieved by artistic authoring and by the work of engineers. And then all of the sketch motions that have been produced by human have been post-processed using trajectory optimization to generate trajectory that are feasible. And when the robot is online, when it knows exactly what it's supposed to do, right? But because of the uncertainties of the environment and so on, it constantly needs to check whether the motion that it's trying to achieve is correct. So what does it do? He looks into a motion database, he does motion matching, he does motion blending, he does motion warping. And if you're working with character animation, all of these notions should be quite familiar to you, right? And so they generate a database of motion, then they query it online. But then this is where computer graphics would stop in general, and you still have many publications that are based on this idea, right? Nowadays, we use machine learning to, you know, I see machine learning in this kind of context as a data compression problem, but it doesn't matter. We query a trajectory and we play it online, or we learn a policy and we execute that policy online to reach our objective. And then on the right-hand side, what you need to do in robotics is that still that motion that you found in your database, in general, you're still not able to execute it directly on your robot, so you need to do trajectory optimization again. But I want to emphasize the fact that this left-hand side of the slide that we see here, it's really computer graphics, okay? And I believe that in the recent years, through the use of simulation in particular, and through the use of physics simulator, the way that people address the problem of motion synthesis for legged robots or legged characters is starting to merge, right? So as an example of this, I want to first show the work, again, some very impressive work that was achieved by ETH Zurich. And probably this work is much less known, but I believe it's at least as impressive as what people do at Boston Dynamics, right? And the idea that we have now, and especially with the advent of AI, is to say, when we're going to try to learn this policy, we don't necessarily need a database of motion. We can try to use a physics simulator and sample the behaviors. By sampling, I just mean, you know, using random inputs, random commands, and try to reach our objective. So when you do that in a simulator, you can generate motions like this, okay? So this is, again, some very impressive work that was achieved by this team. So this is a very robust gated behavior from the Animal C robot. It's in the Swiss forest, right? I'm not going to show you the video, but I want you to observe the simulation, how far away from the reality it is, right? It has been trained on a very simple simulation, but you still obtain some very robust behavior. And by robust, I mean, in this video, they were able to follow a mountain track for more than 1.5 hours, you know, climbing a mountain, going down, walking on snow, crossing a river without the robot ever falling, okay? And this is through the use of machine learning, but especially through the use of simulation and using simulations to try to compute a solution and to learn a policy. And of course, in the computer graphics community, we have been doing this for a while. For closed deformation, for instance, for closed simulation, we had an interesting talk about this just before. But for character animation, it was not so common. We of course had people like Karen Liu, who worked on it, who was kind of pioneering it, I believe. More recently, you had also some trajectory optimization methods that are based on sampling in physics simulator by Hämäläinen in 15, and you can see that it can generate real-time without any pre-computation, like very complex behaviors. And most recently, closer to us, there is the work from Jason Tang, who was also working on policy learning with a twist. And the idea here was to say that because I still have this component that is prominent in graphics, that I want my emotions to look good, I'm going to give a prior to my character. I'm going to train my character in a physics simulator to track what we see here is a running behavior, right? So you learn a policy that mimic this behavior. And what is the interest of that? The interest of that is generality. Because during your training, what you do after this, after you have trained your model, then you add perturbation to your system, right? You add obstacles, sometimes you throw stuff at the character. And while you're doing the learning, you try to robustify your policy, and then suddenly you're able to generate diversity in the motion that you obtain, okay? And so I believe that through the simulation and also through the use of machine learning, but in my opinion, it's not maybe the most prominent thing, those two communities are really converging to a general approach and a general formulation of the problem that is quite relevant. And still the big issue that remains and what we're trying to do here is to try to solve this question of how to explore a very large search space, okay? We're talking about a problem that is really high dimensional. The dimension of the problem is roughly equal or proportional to the number of degrees of freedom of your robot. So humanoid has about 30 degrees of freedom, a real human much more than that. So this is about the dimension of our space and the potential. And we have, of course, a space that is continuous or discontinuous of infinitely many actions that we can take at any time, you know, to achieve our task. And so to try to reduce this search space, what we have seen is that you can use reference motions, and then you can use your simulation to try to learn a policy or to use optimal control to do trajectory optimization and obtain the motion that you want. This is very good. I already mentioned that this had interesting generalization properties, but those are only local, right? If you use a reference motion that consists in running, then you can have some variation around the running behavior, but suddenly you're not going to start doing backflips or whatever. And the other alternative that has been proposed so far is to just go completely brute force on this, right? Is to going to say, you know what, I'm going to put my simulators in parallel. I'm going to set environments where I can run, 60 instances of my problem on my GPUs, and I'm going to do reinforcement learning with that. Okay? And this has proven to be very efficient. There was a demonstration at ICRA two years ago where while the presenter was talking, the quadruped robot animal that we saw earlier was learning how to walk in 2 minutes, right? He was talking, and by the end of the demonstration, the robot was just going around the scene. So this works very well, but at the same time, it's very efficient from a time point of view, but it's still quite inefficient in terms of the efficient sampling of the space, right? So there is this first question that I would like to address today, which is, can we try to guide the search a little more? And related to that, when we use simulation, as opposed to when we use trajectory optimization, we lose a lot of information that we already have on our system, right? When you do reinforcement learning, what you do is you design a reward policy, okay? And your reward policy, in general, it's really high level, actually. It can get quite complex, but the idea is, I'm going to give you a reward for reaching your objective. And when you design this reward, what you completely ignore is the dynamic models of your system. You ignore completely the laws of physics. They are implicitly represented in your reward, right? Otherwise, it wouldn't work at all. But you don't have any information. All this information, all these models that you have of your environment, you completely ignore it. And that's, I believe, one reason why the convergence of machine learning algorithm for character animation in physics world is so slow, okay? And if you do trajectory optimization, on the other hand, trajectory optimization, you explicitly specify the model. It's a model-based approach. You set your dynamics equations, you add some constraints, and if you're able to converge locally to a feasible trajectory, you have the guarantee that your constraints are satisfied. But On the other hand, you only have computed one trajectory. It's quite slow to solve. And of course, you're not happy with that. And the idea, ideally, is to combine both, right? You would like to get within your reward or within, even better, the design of your machine learning framework, you would like to include information about the physics and the constraints, okay? And this is the second part that I'm going to discuss about. So that was a long introduction, but I think it was kind of necessary to make these things clear. And now I'm going to talk about a few illustrations of these questions and to present how I approach this problem in general. So the real application that I've been targeting is this one, right? We have seen a lot of examples that are very impressive of robots, you know, that are able to run, walk, jump, these kind of things. But when the environment is unstructured, and when you consider a robot such as HRP2, which is really constrained geometrically, you can see that it becomes quite complicated to plan this kind of motion. There are a lot of contact changes and repositioning, and getting up is quite slow. You need to account for all of the constraints, and it's really hard to challenge and this, to address. And this kind of challenge at the moment, no one is really able to solve them efficiently. Okay, machine learning, there are only a few contributions who have tried to actually solve this problem, but we don't know very well how to do it at the moment. So why is this problem hard? I think it's important to remind this. I already mentioned that we have some kind of a curse of dimensionality. We're working in a very large space, and this space is really weirdly shaped in the sense that this space is very large and infinite, of course, high dimensional. But in this space, in general, we are only interested in a subset of configurations or postures for our characters. Those are the postures where the character is not in collision with anything and which is and where it is actually in contact with any, with something, right? And this is called the contact manifold. And scientifically or formally, this means that the issue is that this contact manifold has a zero null measure. What that means effectively is that if you randomly try to sample a state in contact, you will never find it, okay? The other issue that we have is that the dynamics of our system, even if we know them, we have the Newton-Euler equation, we can write them, they are really hard to work with because they are discontinuous. Whenever I create contact with the environment, I change the constraints and I change the dynamic properties of my system. And I'm talking for character with legs, of course, not for mobile robot or something. And then once you have tackled this issue, you have another issue, which is that you also have to deal with collision constraints. And I think people in computer graphics are much more familiar with this particular problem. And this is also a discontinuous and nonlinear problem. Okay. And during my PhD, I think the main contribution of my PhD is just this slide, to be honest, because I've been using it for the last 8 years, because I think it's still really relevant, and it defines the way we consider the problem when we work in robotics. It was a formalism of the idea of saying this problem is simply too hard to solve. Is it too hard for modern machine learning techniques? We'll see, right? I won't dare making a prognostic at this point. And because it's too hard, we're just going to break it down into three different problems. Nowadays, I tend to break it down in four, but it doesn't make a big difference, right? And I'm going to call this problem P1, P2, and P3. And I'm going to say, if I want the robot, the purple robot on the left hand of the screen to get to the blue position, what I'm first going to do, I'm first going to think of an abstraction of my robot. I'm not going to think about contacts. I'm not going to think of anything like that. I'm just going to say, you know, have kind of a guide path that my robot should follow, or my virtual character, to get from that position A to the goal position B, okay? And along that path, then, I will have sufficiently reduced my search space. And if I have sufficiently reduced my search space, maybe I have a hope of rapidly computing a sequence of contact position or contact plan that will tell me how my character should move in the environment. And once I have done that, my last problem, which is the problem P3, is to actually interpolate or use this contact plan to generate a whole body motion, okay? And when you do that, you make a big mistake, which is to say that I assume that I can solve the problem P1, I can find a guide for my robot without having any idea of, you know, what are the problem P2 and P3. And obviously this is very wrong. And so you need to solve a problem in the feasibility domain of the other problems. What does that mean? Very simply, it means that if I have intuitively, if I want to climb the stairs, I have a rough idea that from here to here, my trunk or my center of mass will always be between, I don't know, 1.2 meter and 1.50 meters from the ground or from any stair step, right? Those are the kind of constraints that you're going to say. And maybe if you specify this, then it means that there is a chance that along this guide path that you're considering, you can generate contact. But it doesn't say much about the dynamics of your system. Anyway, you need to think about this. And what I would like to show you today, the point is that when you make this kind of decomposition and when you start thinking specifically not about solving your problem, but actually about characterizing that feasibility domain thing, then you can get really interesting results. Okay? And so now I want to talk about that. I want to talk about approximating a so-called feasibility domain. So what do I mean by that? So let's go very abstract just for one slide. Okay, you have this like weird double triangle shape in blue on the left side of the screen, like right here. And this is a feasible space, okay, for your problem. You know that if you sample a point in arbitrary dimension, if it's within this space, then you won. It's part of your solution. In general, there is no analytical form for the system, okay? So you need to approximate it. And you can approximate it with a necessary condition. This is the big red triangle that I have here. I know that for a point to be part of my solution, it needs to be in the red triangle. But I know that this is not a sufficient condition because I can have false positives here. And likewise, you can also often find sufficient conditions. Like you can say, if my point is in the smaller red triangle, then I'm sure that I am part of the solution, but maybe I'm missing a lot of solutions, okay? And the sad truth about locomotion is that in general, you don't even have either a necessary or sufficient condition. You just have something weird like this, right? This kind of red rectangle that you see here. And this is your starting point, and this is what we call a heuristic, okay? And what I advocate for, and what maybe is not so well received in the community, I believe it's changing, is that I plea for incremental work, right? The work is to go from the ugly red rectangle to something that approximates as best as possible that feasible workspace, okay? So let's see an example of that, and let's see an example of an incremental work. So I'm going to talk about something that I developed during my PhD. I'm going to go very fast about this, and then I'm going to say how we have tried to use machine learning to improve this and the results that we obtained. So let's talk about the problem P1, okay? Again, I'm at the bottom of the stairs. I want to go to the top of the stairs. And during my PhD, we had like this very stupid idea, which was to say, okay, here's on the left, you see the IQ robot. It has four legs and it has a trunk. And again, people in computer graphics will be familiar with that. We're going to say, whatever happens, I know the trunk, I don't want it to be in collision, okay? So I'm just going to take a bounding box of that trunk and I'm just going to say, whatever happens, this will never be in collision. And I'm going to say, this is a constraint for my problem. And then I'm going to take the reachable workspace of each of my arm. I'm going to over-approximate it. And then I'm going to say, if I want to create a contact with the wall, well, basically, I need to have the role within the reachable workspace of my shoulder, which means that if I'm here, it's not working, I need to step back a bit, and then I'm able to create a contact with the wall, okay? So really stupid heuristic, and let's see how far we were able to go with that, okay? And then we use like sampling-based planning to say, let's try to climb the stairs, okay? So we plan a pass and we only had this constraint, like whatever happens, the red box is never in collision, so this is easy, and whatever happens, the four green bubbles that we have here, they always have to be in collision, okay? And then, once you have done that, if you have a contact planner, and I don't want to talk at all about contact planning today, so I'm just going to say, I have a magic black box function that just generates a contact plan. You might be able to generate one, okay? And we had like some interesting successes with that, but the success rate, depending on the situations, of course, they were not so good, right? An example of a failure case is here, like same kind of approximated bubble for the humanoid robot Talos. And we are only interested in the fit here. And we say, okay, this is our constraints when we are planning a path. We're just going to say, you know what? We want the two green bubbles that represent the fit of the robot to be in collision all the time. And on this scene, you can find something like that. Actually, the straight line satisfies the constraint. And obviously, it's a very bad guide for your robot, especially if you constrain the localization of the trunk, because here it's stuck. It doesn't know where to put the left foot, right? And this is because we have kind of an approximation of a necessary condition, but definitely not a sufficient one. And then this is where we started to think about using machine learning. When I say when, this is like 6 years later, okay? So this was Jason Schumann, who was my PhD student at the time, and he said, okay, let's try to start from that heuristic that you created that was kind of handcrafted and kind of naive, and let's try to see if we can improve it, okay? So we developed a generator for an arena, and we randomly set up, you know, some scenarios where the robot will start in random position and go from one position and he would have the task of going from one position to the other, okay? And we would say, whatever you do, the paths that you generate, they have to satisfy these constraints, these bubble constraints that I've been defining before. And then we added another term in the reward function using a very classic reinforcement learning algorithm. We said, after you've computed your trajectory, you're going to execute the contact planner. And based on whether or not you are able to compute a contact plan, you're going to compute a reward and feedback that reward to your learning system. Okay? And that was it, okay? At the time, we didn't have a GPU, so it took some time for training, but it took 53 hours, okay? The same training without that stupid condition that I mentioned before, it was hundreds of hours, and it never actually converged. And the success rate for this were actually amazing, okay? I'm going to talk about first the qualitative aspect of it. So we can see that you have a very small adaptation in this case, right? But suddenly, the difference is that you are able to compute a contact plan. And again, this seems like quite naive. But what is interesting with this kind of policy, as we can see, other results are unfolding, but this is just to say that we are able to cross a variety of environments. This changed everything. The success rate that we obtain with this, when we are planning the motion for our contact planners, are above 98%, okay, of success rate. But the success rate is good, but this is not the only interesting part. Is that because we have reduced the search space so much, when we're trying to solve the subsequent problem of computing a contact sequence or computing a motion, we've been from computation time that used to take minutes to actually get there to the order of milliseconds, okay? And the order of milliseconds is actually what we need to do online computation, right? So I'm just going to show just a few examples of what we have been able to achieve with this. And you can see like the robots on the top right, you've seen it already. The robot on the left is the solo robot. So someone is driving it with a joystick here. And you can see that the planning is done at a really high frequency. So it's more than 200 hertz. And you can see that in this case, we have a perfect knowledge of the world, but the robot is able to constantly adapt their footstep as it's been asked to, you know, fool around the stairs. And this level of robustness, we are not really able to have it. So I believe a lot of credit in these videos is to be given actually to the contact planning method, to the contact planner and the trajectory generation method that we have. But still, the fact that it's real time and the fact that we're able to run it on a robot, it comes from this naive heuristic that we crafted and through the fact that we've improved this heuristic through the use of machine learning. Okay, and this just doesn't work with our current knowledge. Okay, if you just try to do reinforcement learning on the same problem without any goal at first, okay? Not at least with the same success rate that we obtain. And we also had a few computer graphics applications for it. And in this motion, like actually like 5% of the motion is not physically consistent, and I think it's quite easy to see where this is not happening. And so the conclusion of this first example that I wanted to show is that I really believe that we should use heuristics, okay? I already mentioned that we had over 98% of success rates, and the failure cases are like very edge cases that, I mean, I'm not sure you can really deal efficiently with reinforcement learning, but maybe you could, I don't know. And this was leveraged through the use, again, of the introduction of a model within a machine learning framework and through the use of a simulation. And by a simulation here, you can see that I was not necessarily referring to a physics-based simulation that is quite heavy, but something simple enough to represent the difficulties of the problem that I'm trying to solve. Okay? All right. So a second example that I want to discuss now is this problem that I call P3, which is the issue of generating a whole body motion problem. So we come back again to the stress that we have both in the computer graphics world and in robotics of computation time, right? There are many problems. We know how to solve them, actually. If we are given even time, enough time to compute them, then we can solve them. There was a discussion this morning, you know, about using GPU and in video games, you know, the fight over getting some CPUs or GPU cycles for doing your computation. Well, in robotics, it's much less complex than that, but we still have this issue of we constantly need to recompute the motion of our robot because we don't want it to fall, okay? And we have this issue in robotics, which is that we need to plan several steps ahead, okay? You can't just plan the next step of your robot and hope that it will not fall. In our experience, it never works. A better example to show that is a bit more extreme and that can make more sense is that if you think of a robot that is, or a virtual character that is walking, and at some point there is a gap, and the gap is very large, maybe 2 meters large. And the only way to cross the gap, of course, for the robot is to start running, gain momentum, and jump. And if you don't have this window over the future, there is no way you're going to plan for that, right? So even when you're dealing with graphics, you cannot just plan for the next frame, which is often what we do, by the way, right? So we have like very reactive systems. And if you need to jump, you're just not going to be able to jump unless you have that preview window. But the issue that we have, if we start considering these preview windows with methods such as model predictive control or trajectory optimization, is that it takes a lot of time to compute these motions. So, and again, what can you do about this? So the first option is to say, I'm just going to solve this large problem, and then I will run it. And online is never going to work because it's about a few seconds to solve the problem. And by the way, the difficulty is not really, the computation time does not increase linearly. Like if I'm planning for a motion for 2 seconds, it's not twice as short as if I am planning for a motion that lasts 4 seconds, right? How the complexity increases, it depends on many things that are not really relevant for what I'm trying to say here. But anyway, and so the other option that you can use again is to say I'm going to use an approximated model. And this is something that we do a lot in computer graphics. I think like most contribution in computer graphics is work on what the so-called centroidal dynamics, right? You consider the equations of the dynamics that apply at the center of mass of your robot or your virtual character. You assume that everything else doesn't have any mass and you just make your computation like this. This is an example of an approximated model, okay? And we can't do much better than that, okay? And again, we are at the starting point where, with respect to our feasible space, we're starting from this red rectangle here, okay? And the idea that we had was to say, we have this issue that we need a model of the world that is very accurate, okay? Because otherwise, our robot will fall. And maybe in graphics, you don't have this problem. So I need my robot to be robust and to do this, there is no way but to model and solve a complex problem, okay? But the way model predictive control works, as I said before, is you plan 5 seconds ahead of time, in time, because you need to do that. We've tried it. If you plan just 2 seconds, it's not working, the robot is going to fall, okay? So I'm giving you arbitrary times, but it's just to give you an idea. And so you know you need to play 5 seconds ahead, but at the same time, you know that over these 5 seconds that you plan, you're just going to execute the first second. Because while you're executing the first second, you start planning again for the future, okay? And so there was this idea of saying, maybe I only need to be very accurate for the first second. And even if I still need to plan for the next 4 seconds, I can be quite relaxed and use simpler models, okay? And we tried exactly that, okay? And we called it multi-fidelity residing horizon planning. This was not my idea. And so the idea is this one. We have a very complex model of the first step that the robot is going to make. And for the future step, we use a simplified model, okay? And the only objective of this is not an objective of saying we're going to have a better convergence in the problems that we're solving or we're going to find a better solution. No, we know that we are not. The only objective that we have is we try to solve this in real time to execute it while our robot is moving. Okay. And when we did that, we realized that for a lot of simple scenes, such as the one that you see here, again, we were using a generator, actually it works pretty well. Okay. We were able to solve the problem quite a lot of time. But if you look at this table here, you can see two columns. There is one that is the offline success, where the success rate is quite interesting. I'm going to tell you what those methods are in a second. And you have the online success rate, which is quite less interesting. Okay. So we tested the three methods that are described here, like the RHP 1, 2, and 3, were three different models that were simplified of the dynamics of the robot that we tested. Okay, and the first model that we tested, it was the simpler one, and obviously we saw that it was not working at all. So I'm not going to elaborate too much on that. The other two models, offline, they gave a really good approximation, a really good success rate. Okay, and the baseline is just the case where you solve the very complex trajectory optimization problem, and you take all the time in the world to solve it. The online setup is the exact same setup, but you give a maximum time to solve the problem. You say you have like 500 milliseconds to solve the problem, okay? And when you do that, you can see that the baseline is not working very well. So we only had like 51% success rate. Just meant that we cut the solver before it converged, and so we didn't converge. But the methods that we proposed, we saw an improvement, but it was not so great, okay? And more importantly, we had very little generalization that was obtained, because as soon as we started to make the scenes more complex, the success rate was actually going down, whereas the trajectory optimization was working well. So what this means, again, is that we were in a case where we had a very conservative approach. And not only we were not able to gain significant gains in the computational efficiency, but the model that we had was not smart enough. And this is kind of a failure, right? Because if you remind that example of the character who is running with this reference motion capture, the idea is to say we want to go beyond that. We don't want to tell the character that it needs to run. We want it to be autonomous with respect to the environment. And so what we try to do, coming back to this idea of trying to model the physics into your training, we didn't take a reinforcement learning approach. We took a supervised learning approach. And the idea that we had was to say, the original decomposition I had was, I'm going to plan for the next second very accurately, and I'm going to use a relaxed model to plan for the next 4 seconds. The idea was to say, I'm now only going to plan for the next second. That's it. And if I do this, I have the guarantee that my problem, I will be able to solve it fast enough. But then we come back to this issue of saying, we know that if we only plan 1 second ahead of time, we are going to fail. The robot is not going to be able to solve the problem. So what we did is we use supervised learning to actually get an oracle that will estimate what we call the value function, right? It will estimate where the robot should be after 1 second of planning, such that the motion will be feasible and the robot will not fall in the future. And we use supervised learning to do that. And actually, with this simple approach, we were able to get like a very satisfying success rate. And we were moderately happy with what we obtained. Okay. Happy enough to get a publication, maybe not so happy that you can consider the problem to be done. Okay. And so still there was this idea that we were working on that said that something was still missing, because the way we've been doing it is using trajectory optimization and supervised learning. This is the only way that we had found so far to try to put this dynamic model within the reward of our learning framework. And this was not working very well. And plus, in this particular setup, we are not using or leveraging on the computation capabilities of our system. So, still, the early conclusions that I want to make at this point is that there is no doubt that we can use AI, of course, to further improve the computation of these feasibility models that we're trying to find. Learning collision constraints is something that we are currently working on at the moment. And there is a problem that I didn't talk about here, which is the contact planning problem. And for this specific problem, I still haven't found any relevant contribution in the state of the art, and I have not been able to find one myself that allows us to tackle especially efficiently this problem. Okay. And the key takeaway message that I want to take is that if you make the effort of modeling your problem, trying to learn this feasibility space, then you can reinsert them within a reinforcement learning framework, you know, because they're so trendy and for good reason, because they work very well. And you can dramatically accelerate the convergence of your system. But still, what we have not been able to do, and it was one of the questions I was raising before, is to try to leverage properly the domain knowledge of your system, and in this case, the physics constraints of your system. Okay, so, and the idea was to say, we know that when we use optimal control, trajectory optimization, we have this information, and how can we try to leverage it in machine learning? And this is ongoing work that has been achieved by my student, Daniel Laigui. This is under review and under submission. And basically, so this slide is just restating what I've been doing, which is that the only way that we know how to use trajectory optimization in a machine learning context at the moment is to say, I'm going to generate a database of trajectory, and then I'm going to do a function approximation, to learn a function approximator using machine learning to be able to online synthesize this trajectory. But when I'm doing this, I don't take into account the constraints of my problem, and so I'm not really efficiently leveraging on it, right? And so the idea that we had was to say, we're going to work on a formulation of a machine learning problem that will directly incorporate our dynamic constraints. And for this, we had this idea that was, I mean, proposed by others before us, but we had this idea to use it in a robotics context, to use a special form of neural networks that are called neural ODE for ordinary differential equation. And the idea was to say that we had specifically nodes that were designed to solve optimal control equations while we were trying to run and learn an optimal policy. Okay? I'm not going to elaborate too much on the details of that because I see that the clock is running and I think it's quite mice heavy. But we have early results that we submitted. And when I say early results, I think the theory of this is well grounded. The results that we have, I call them early because they have been demonstrated on small problems, right? On dumb problems. We tested all of the problems in the OpenAI GYM environment. And every single of these problems, we have significantly outperformed most of the setup for most of the methods that come with GYM. And this is the case, for instance, for PPO. And in this problem that I'm going to show you rapidly, the idea is that you have a cart pole to which is attached a pendulum, and the point is to maintain this cart pole in equilibrium. Okay, and you can see that this is the work that we have achieved. This is our policy, and it's able to maintain the pole for some time. Okay, this is the final policy that we obtain. And if we look at the other framework, so this is PPO. I think there is, after hours and hours of training, it's never able to find a policy that actually allows to sustain the table. And we have the same thing from the soft actor critique. Okay, and you can see that this is actually completely diverging. All right, so this is very early work, and I won't elaborate too much on this. I know the talk is quite heavy. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'm really happy to take any questions. Thank you.